Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Keller, your host. Thanks so much for being here with us on this Monday afternoon. Maybe it's Monday evening or even Tuesday morning where you are, depending on where you are around the globe. So nice to be back here after the weekend and to get to do this again. And we have two very, very fine guests for you this hour. Second hour, John Martignoni will be here with us. And I'll just be honest with you. I'll tell you, we have this meeting at the end of the year. We go, how can we be a better radio show in the next year? And one of the suggestions that both Darren and I agreed to, we got to have John Martignoni on more. That's how you get a better radio show. This hour, one of the best, wearing his almost but not quite Charlie Brown shirt, Trent Horn. Hello, Trent Horn. Happy 2023.
Well, don't say that I'm a Charlie Brown character. You're going to give me a big head.
Yes, I don't. All right. You remember
that? God, that was a good one. Come on.
That was a good one. Yes, that was good. Remember how the Charlie Brown characters would cry, where they would, they're just, their whole face would be like become their mouth? Anyways, don't get me off track to start with. We're going to do Why Aren't You Catholic? So this, we need non-Catholics to call. We invite non-Catholics to call. It'll be a terrible Why Aren't You Catholic show if no non-Catholics call. Maybe you're a Protestant brother or sister and you got a reason why you do not believe that the Catholic Church represents the true faith. Maybe you're not a believer at all and you want to tell us why you are not a believer. Any reason at all. If you're I don't believe in God, or I don't, why would I pick one religion over another, or the Romans Road, or whatever you got, 888-318-7884. The number. Trent Horn is the author of a whole bunch of books, including the very popular Why We're Catholic. So there's a perfect tie into this program today. Trent, again, thanks very much for being here with us. How is your 2023 going?
It's going well. I actually just finished a course on answering Protestant arguments that I submitted for our Catholic Answer School of Apologetics, so hopefully we'll have that available sometime next summer. And yeah, I've just enjoyed, you know, it's always hard getting off of the holidays back into the swing of regular life, but it's good. We've also had unseasonably warm weather out here in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. So last year we had snowpocalypse. This year we're even seeing some days that are in the 80. So can't complain about that in January.
Wow. Man, no, yeah. You cannot complain about that in January.
You know what? Sometimes I do. On my phone, Si, I keep weather, you know, what is the weather in different cities of friends and people that I know. And every now and then, you know, I'll look at San Diego. I'm like, oh, San Diego, always. But then sometimes I go, oh, this is the same weather as here. Never mind. All good. So.
Well, very well, right now we're having an atmospheric river. And I don't know if you remember what an atmospheric river is. But
I think it was a band from the 70s.
Yeah, they were good, too. Very, yeah.
No, kind of sorry. I'm thinking of Atmospheric River Revival. Sorry, my bad.
Revival. Traveling medicine show. Atmospheric River is rain. We're getting rain out here in California. But we call it an atmospheric river. We just need to impress the rest of the nation. We're having an atmospheric river. Again, 888-318-7884. Why aren't you Catholic? That's our topic this hour. Trent and I, both of us are Catholic. I was one in the cradle. Trent, a convert to the Catholic faith. We love the Catholic faith. We're not shy about that. We're not trying to trick anybody. We just love having conversations with people who are not about why they are not. You ready to start? Because already the lines are filling up there, Trent.
I am ready. I do want to say, Si, we talk about cradle Catholics and converts. I'm just waiting for the story of someone who is a baby genius who decided to become Catholic so they could be both a cradle Catholic and
right.
a convert.
Yeah, the convert to the Catholic faith while still in the cradle. You'd have to do it in the first, I don't know, 8, 9. Well, no, babies start walking around, what, 12 months? You got a lot of babies. How many, Darren? 12 months?
You could be in cradles till you're like 12, 18 months. Baby genius out there becomes Catholic. That's what I want to see.
All right.
Cradle convert.
Herschel's in Overland Park, Kansas, watching us on Catholic.com. Herschel, we're glad you're here. Why aren't you Catholic?
Well, gentlemen, thank you for taking my call tonight. I will tell you why we're not Catholic yet, and that's because I think we're confused and probably a little bit of an analysis paralysis. My wife and I are both Protestant. We were both raised, she was raised Baptist. I was raised in the Assemblies of God. we spent 3 years in the Roman Catholic Church. We went through the RCIA program. That was really good. We have a wonderful priest who's our dear friend, and he was adamant. He said, if you can't say yes and amen to everything that Holy Mother Church teaches, you shouldn't join the church. There's enough cafeteria Catholics. And so at that point in time, towards the end of RCIA, we were struggling with purgatory, the idea of mortal and venial sin, the idea that, you know, if I live a good life and I do one mortal sin at the wrong time and get hit by a bus, it's sorry, game's over, you're not coming to heaven. I think I had some misunderstandings about what mortal and venial sin was that later got cleared up. Okay. But we eventually, we've taken kind of a detour to Constantinople. One day this word orthodoxy pops into my head, and I'm glad it did. We've spent the last year in an Orthodox church. Mm-hmm. It's an Orthodox church in America parish. 95% of the people in that church are converts, so 5% are cradle Orthodox. Mm-hmm. None of which really have spent as much time in the Roman Church as we have. And we've listened to a lot of good teaching on both sides. You know, both churches are equally old. Both churches are apostolic. Both churches have the same sacraments. But there's some major differences between the two churches theologically. Like I said, we're confused. There's wonderful people in both churches.
Yeah, what do you think is the biggest thing confusing you right now? Were you still wondering about the mortal sin stuff, or is it more a thing between Catholics and Orthodox?
You know, the main thing is, I think for me, is the role of Peter, the papacy, in the first 1,000 years of the church. Because when you listen to our Orthodox brothers and sisters, they'll say that it was the Pope in Rome who said, I want to be the Bishop of Bishops, I'm going to be the head honcho, you guys are going to submit to me. And they make it sound like Rome just kind of went off and did their own thing.
All right, let's let Trent address that at least. Go ahead, Trent.
Sure, Herschel. The question you've asked, you know, the relationship of the papacy to the other patriarchs and bishops in the early church in the first 1,000 years, I will be honest with you, is beyond the scope of being able to address well in the next few minutes that I have. So what I'd like to do rather is give you just some encouragement of where I would go forward if you wanted to examine this question. First, I think you should ask, when it comes to I would look at the biblical evidence, and then I would look at the historical evidence. So first, you should ask yourself, all right, amongst all the apostles, what was Jesus's leadership plan for the apostles? Was it for all of them to be equals, that none of them stand out with a leadership role in relation to the others? Or did Peter have a special leadership role that all of them were equally apostles, but Peter had a special role to unite them and to lead them? So that would be number one, look at it biblically. To help you with that, I will send you a copy of my friend Joe Heschmeyer's new book, Pope Peter. So that would be a resource for the biblical question, how should we look at Peter? Then number two, when you look at the historical evidence, it can get sort of, there could be minutiae, there can be a lot of historical intricacies, but I would look at the big picture. All right, when I look at the early church, did the Bishop of Rome, the Church of Rome, similar to what I asked of Peter, did it have a special authority in relation to other churches, or is the more uniform testimony that all of the churches have equal authority? The problem is you can read some texts that point one way, some that point another way, but I am convinced when you look at the historical evidence from very early on, you see there is a recognition in the church that the Bishop of Rome is the successor of Peter and has very unique authority, and we see this in the letter of Clement. We see this in the letter that Ignatius wrote to the church at Rome, where he uses very affirming language of the church at Rome that he does not use for any other church. We see it in the Pope settling disputes, in different saints in the early church coming to the Pope to seek resolutions. So for that, so I'd recommend Joe Heschmeyer's book, Pope Peter. When it comes to the historical question, there is a new book out on this question, very excited about, that I'd recommend that you would pick up, okay? And that is called The Papacy, Revisiting the Debate Between Catholics and Orthodox by Eric Ibarra, Y-B-A-R-R-A. I haven't had a chance to read it yet, but from what I've heard from people, it's very good. Eric is one of the best defenders of the Catholic view of the papacy. What I like about Eric is he tries to be very careful with his evidence. So the book is called The Papacy, Revisiting the Debate Between Catholics and Orthodox. It's published by the St. Paul Center for Biblical Theology. So stay on the line. Let's get your email. We'll send you Pope Peter. But if you want to dive into the historical debate, like what was the role of the papacy in the first millennia, I would recommend Ibarra's book, The Papacy, Eric Ibarra, Y-B-A-R-R-A. Hopefully that's I hope that is helpful for you, and do stay on the line so you can get free book from us.
We do have to go to a break, however, so Herschel, hang on. We'll send you Pope Peter from our friend Joe Heschmeyer. The number is 888-318-7884. The question of the hour: why aren't you Catholic? If you're not a Catholic and you want to talk with Trent Horn, who wrote the book Why We're Catholic, you are welcome to call here. 888-318-7884.
Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
EWTN Global Catholic Network is the largest religious media network in the world. 11 global TV channels, English and Spanish radio networks with over 500 AM and FM radio affiliates, one of the largest Catholic websites in the world, dozens of podcasts every week, social media, electronic and print news services, and EWTN publishing. EWTN is the global Catholic network. For more about EWTN, visit EWTN.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Trent Horn, our guest this hour. Next hour, John Martignoni here with us. And this hour, it's always fun for us, and we hope it's fun for the caller, or at least interesting for the caller, when we do these Why Aren't You Catholic hours, because lots of folks have reasons that are quite compelling, and we love to discuss them. If you want to be a little bit challenging, that's fine. Don't feel like you're hijacking the show. If you've got a what you feel is a very basic question or very basic stumbling block, don't worry, it's all welcome. 888-318-7884. Derek in Wisconsin is next, listening on 88.5 FM. Derek, thank you for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Trent. Oh, wait a second. Hang on, Derek. I was supposed to say, why aren't you Catholic?
Okay, well, I'm a Pentecostal right now, so I still love you guys in Christ. But a question that I have that I don't understand is, why do Catholics worship and pray to other saints or people in the Bible like Mary?
Okay. Well, Derek, thank you for your question, but I will have to rephrase the question a bit because it contains a false premise. It's what we would call a loaded question. It would be like if I asked Cy Kellett, Cy, when was the last time you cheated on your taxes? You know, it's
every
you can't
time.
Answer, it would just
oh, sorry, right. I forgot we were on the air. Go ahead.
I don't think religious radio is admissible in court because of the separation of church and state. Maybe, Cy? I don't know. You have to look at that loophole. So, Derek, when you say, do Catholics worship the saints, we do not give divine worship. The only person who receives divine worship in Catholicism is a member of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the word worship, you can think of it as meaning something's worth-ship. There is an older sense of the word worship that just means to give someone the honor that they are due. We do this all the time nowadays. Like if you walk into a court, you say to the judge, Your Honor, and you stand up. So you're giving the judge respect of what he's worth, but obviously not the same respect that you would give to God. So Catholics do not worship saints with the worship we give to God, like offering sacrifice, but we do venerate. We pay respect to the saints, and we ask them to pray for us. So the phrase pray to the saints can be a little bit confusing, because when you think of praying to someone, we think, oh, well, that means you're worshiping them. But they're not actually the same thing. Like, you could pray to someone without worshiping them. I'll give you an example. If an atheist prays to God, God, if you're there, give me a sign. He's not worshiping God. He doesn't even know if God exists. He's asking something of God in his prayer. So prayer with to the saints, how it's often described, it's a way of seeking intercession. So just as I would ask Psychelet to pray for me, I would ask other people to pray for me. A better term to use might be seeking the intercession of the saints. So we seek the saints' intercession, and what we believe is that there is only one body of Christ. And the saints are united to the body. We are united to the body. We believe the saints are in heaven with Jesus, so they're not dead. They're alive in Christ. They're aware of what happens on earth, and they would desire to pray for us, intercede for us like anyone else. And as James 5:16 says, the prayers of a holy person are very powerful. So not all prayers are equally efficacious. If you ask a very holy person to pray for you, there's a difference there. And we apply the same thing to the saints. So I would say that that's the reasoning behind it. There's nothing in the Bible to condemn this practice. And so I think it's something acceptable for Christians to do. I guess I would start there. Do you have any questions, or would you like a follow-up? Go right ahead.
Yeah, I would like to follow up with that. Could you point me to somewhere in Scripture that I could read about when anyone prays to somebody other than God? Because also, from my understanding, mm-hmm. I believe it talks of the Holy Spirit interceding for us. So, mm-hmm. you know, at where my knowledge base is right now, I am unaware that you could pray to somebody in heaven other than God or Jesus or through the Holy Spirit. So could you clarify that up maybe a little bit for me?
Sure. So it sounds like your question also has another premise built into it, saying where in Scripture do we see believers praying to someone who is not God, who is not a member of the Trinity? And I think a premise you have built into that is we should only pray to the individuals that we should only follow the biblical example of prayer. So I guess, I mean, there's two ways I could go about your question, right? Well, I guess one way, a shortcut, is I could say, well, Catholics don't pray to saints. We ask them to pray for us, and we just ask them with a mental communication, because we know that God can lift our thoughts up to the saints. We don't pray to them. God takes our request to them, and then they pray to us, or God has given them the ability to hear our request. I know that might not be as satisfying of an answer, like I'm trying to seek a technicality or something, but I could say, well, we don't pray to them. We make a request, and through the power of God, the way only God knows, the saints understand it, and they pray for us, just like I make requests of people on earth. But if you say, I don't really buy that, you're still praying to them, you're just describing it another way. All right, then what I would say here is that we have to be careful. And I would say in the New Testament, I don't see an example of necessarily of someone on earth seeking the intercession of the saints like Catholics do today. The closest example might be in the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 5. It talks about the saints who are in heaven, the elders in heaven. It talks about angels bringing the prayers of the saints to them. So it talks about prayers and requests being brought to saints that are in heaven. So I think that we have some image of that possibly in Revelation, but nothing explicit. So I don't think there's explicit reference to this, but I would just challenge the premise. I would say, okay, well, by that logic, we can only imitate the prayers we find in Scripture. I would say it's very hard to find an explicit prayer to the Holy Spirit. So I might say, Derek, like, can I pray to the Holy Spirit? Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Like, do you see anyone in Scripture praying to the Holy Spirit in that way? Or another example might be, do you see anyone in Scripture asking the risen Jesus to forgive them of their sins? You know, so I think there's actually a lot of prayers Protestants are comfortable with that you don't actually find in Scripture, but they're okay with it, even if they don't find them there. So you see what I mean? Like, do you know of an example where someone prays the Holy Spirit like that in Scripture?
No, and to be honest with you, it's not really taught where I go at. I do know that we believe in the oneness of God, but personally, when I have been seeking out the Scriptures, I've been looking at Matthew chapter 6 and noticing that Jesus is praying directly to the Father. I've been praying for clarity on that too, because I can't claim to know it all. You know what I mean?
Sure. Derek, I'd like to get a quick follow-up with you on that. Do you hold to the oneness view of God, which would say there is one God, God is one person, and he exists in like three modes? Is that the view you hold?
You know, I believe that since God is all-powerful and created everything, in the Old Testament, he represented himself as a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And that's how he chose to lead his children. Now, when we look into John's account of the gospel, he says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So I look at it as, since he is so infinite, that he, what three major ways that he shows us to us is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But I mean, ultimately, I find myself wondering, well, where does that end? Who was the fourth man in the fire in the book of Daniel? Was that the Holy Spirit?
Sure.
Was that the angel of the Lord? Do that, you know, so...
Well, so Derek, I have a question then for you. So you believe that Jesus is God?
Of course. Fully God, and fully human.
And the Father is God?
Yes.
So when Jesus is praying, is he talking to another person?
I believe, no, he is talking to the Father, is what Scripture seems to point out.
But he's not talking to another person. He's not having a conversation with someone.
Not to my knowledge, it doesn't seem to be.
Does it kind of... do you think a regular person reading the Bible, when you see they see that Jesus is praying to the Father, how they might come to the idea he is talking to another person who understands him? Like, for example, in John 17:5, Jesus says this, "Father, glorify thou me in thy own presence with the glory which I had with thee before the world was made." Like, when I read that, like, Jesus is saying to the Father, he's talking to someone, and he's saying, glorify me with the presence I had with you before the world was made. It sounds like two different people. I don't know any other way to explain it. Like, when you say he's talking to the Father, what's the difference between him talking to the Father and talking to another divine person?
That I'm unsure of, but I recognize, I believe what he's talking about in that scripture is because, you know, ultimately sin did not exist until Eve was deceived. And, you know, that's the whole reason that Jesus had to come to earth. God in himself had to wrap himself into flesh and come and walk according to the law, but yet not sin, because he's fully God, but fully in flesh, and pay that price because the life is in the blood.
Okay, well, I tell you what, Derek, I think we're coming up on a break here soon anyways. What I'd like to do is send you two books for you to look at, and I hope that you'll have an open mind towards reading them. One will be on the question of Catholicism and deals with issues, Christian issues like the deity of Christ and the existence of God, but also just why Catholics pray to the saints, as you described it. That's a book, Why We're Catholic. I would like to send that to you. The other book that I would like to send to you is a book called All in the Name, and it is a book, a conversion story about Mark McNeil. He was a Oneness Pentecostal who later became Catholic. So if you stay on the line, I would love to send you his conversion story and see some of the concerns that he has about Oneness theology and I think you might find it very helpful. So I'd like to send you all on the name and why we're Catholic, and just stay on the line, give us your email address, we'll get those to you. I hope they're helpful. Feel free to read them. If you have any other further questions about them, don't hesitate to call back. All right?
Thanks, brother.
Thank you, Derek.
Alrighty.
I really appreciated that conversation, Derek. I hope that you will call again, keep us in mind when more questions come up, or also enjoy just listening to the show where you are listening now, because it seemed like that could be a very, very fruitful conversation going forward, and I hope it will be, Derek. Trent Horn's our guest. Thomas is here with a TikTok question right after this. And all this hour, why aren't you Catholic? If you're not a Catholic and you'd like to call and tell us why, 888-318-7884. The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement. But the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whywearepro-life.com.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Want to know more about the origins of the Catholic Church? Joe Heschmeyer explores the beginnings of Christianity. In the early church was the Catholic Church. Joe digs deep into the words and actions of those who lived right after the apostles to refute anti-Catholic claims of how the faith was lived back then. Order your copy of The Early Church Was the Catholic Church today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Janet Williams. Please join us for Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Little legal disclaimer. All claims that have cheated on taxes are false, fictitious, and not related to actual events. Trent Horn is our guest this hour. Do you know what I'm talking about, Darren? Oh, okay. Trent Horn is our guest this hour. Why aren't you Catholic is our topic. I got to read this little thing, and then we'll get back to that. You spent the month of December finding the perfect gifts for all of the loved ones on your list. Now it's time to take care of little old you. Visit shop.catholic.com now and take advantage of our 23 New Year's special. Spend $23 or more at our online shop. shop.catholic.com. Enter the promo code New Year at checkout and save 23%. It's that easy. Save 23% right now at shop.catholic.com by entering the promo code New Year. Our guest is Trent Horn, but our special visitor is Thomas the TikTok Engine. Thomas, you brought us a question from TikTok.
I did, Si. Thanks for that intro. For those who don't know, on our TikTok channel, the username is Catholic Answers. It's very easy to find. And I'll take questions that people ask us through there. I'll come on the show. I'll ask them to the guest. And then when they give me an answer, I'll go back in and make a clip out of that and post that to TikTok. So it's a little content farming service that our apologists provide for us. Thank you very much. And so this person asked, they said, I have not been to church for 2 years. When I did go last week, I was chastised by a warden, and by that I think they mean usher or a greeter, because it's not a prison.
Or possibly this was a prison mass.
Possibly. You know, in that case, there's more questions. But chastised by a warden in front of other parishioners for being late. They asked, is this wrong? And this person didn't specifically say that this is why they're not Catholic, but I thought it was relevant because you could easily imagine someone who gives that as a reason.
Yeah, you have to understand, look, that when God, you know, when there are two kinds of grace. There are sanctifying grace, which fills our hearts with the love of God and allows us to spend eternal life with Him. And then there's actual grace, which I think Carl Keating once famously described as a spiritual kick in the pants. It was either Carl or Jimmy. I can't remember off the top of my head. So when you know, so let's say you do a really, really bad thing, and you are deprived of sanctifying grace, cut off from God. You're not totally cut off because you might feel a desire, you know, I'm going to go to confession and I'm going to make amends. Your desire to go to confession is a response to God's actual grace that He gave you, because God desires the salvation of all people, 1 Timothy 2:4. God wants everyone to be saved, draws people to Him. The problem is the devil does not want people to be saved. So as God draws people to Him, there will be little obstacles along the way. And one of the devil's favorite obstacles are annoying Catholics. It's easily one of his favorite weapons. So versatile, widespread, you don't see it coming, and when you do, it's incredibly irritating. So you could see this of somebody who is going to Mass, and maybe they were hesitating about it, maybe they're purposely late, maybe they're late for, you know, it's no fault of their own. There could be a lot of reasons. And they go, and somebody wants to chastise them about that, or chastise them for the way they're dressed, or whatever it may be. And what I would say is that there is a time and a place to admonish someone for certain behaviors, but you have to use prudence, that if a person is just struggling with going to church at all, maybe criticizing the minor details, you first want to get them comfortable with the habit of coming to church. And then you can emphasize the importance of other things. Now, I will say this, that the person asking this, it's kind of out of line for them to do that, because here's what's interesting and some people don't understand. So, for example, let's say it's a daily Mass and someone arrives late to daily Mass and they go to receive communion. You might want to be like, hey, you can't come late to Mass. You know, you can't just come show up to receive communion. Actually, you can. Canon 843 in the Code of Canon Law says this: sacred ministers cannot deny the sacraments to those who seek them at appropriate times, are properly disposed, and are not prohibited by law from receiving them. So if communion is being given, that's an appropriate time. And if you're not in a state of mortal sin, you're properly disposed, as long as you're not excommunicated. And that's what it basically says in Canon 912. Any baptized person not prohibited by law can and must be admitted to Holy Communion. So you can, if you see there's a Mass going on and you haven't received communion yet, you can go and receive it. Now, of course, there's probably more spiritual benefit to going to the entire Mass, but maybe you have a scheduling conflict and you can't go, or you have to show up late. You can go and receive communion. There is a difference between the obligation to receive communion and the obligation to attend Mass. You're only obligated to receive the Eucharist once a year during the Easter season. You're obligated to attend Mass on Sundays and holy days of obligation. So that's, you know, it's different there. So this person, you know, he doesn't know why this person is late. He was not in the best place to do that. So sorry for the big discursus there. But my point is, look, if you're seeking after God, be aware these spiritual obstacles will present themselves and ask God for help to endure them. Judge what God is giving you through the church, not through the worst we have to suffer through, but through the best that God wants to give us. It would be my advice.
You know, being on Catholic social media, being the social media person here, I know a thing or two about those annoying Catholics you're talking about. The remedy is to fix your eyes on Jesus, I found out.
You might want to, if you notice the speck in your neighbor's eye, there could be a whole log, a whole forest, right in your own eye. A wise guy said that once, smart guy. Or maybe, I think it was Mother Teresa.
Well, thanks, so. Thomas. Why aren't you Catholic this hour on Catholic Answers Live and a bunch more calls? I want to get to them because we don't have that much time left with Trent. We're going to go to Illinois. Brandon in Illinois listening on 88.5 FM. Brandon, thanks for your call. Why aren't you Catholic?
Hi. So I could get behind asking the saints for prayer, just like how you would ask a brother for prayer, but what I don't understand is, if they're not God, and let's say there's tons of people around the world praying to a specific saint, how they would hear all of those prayers and then handle all of them if they're not God. They're not omniscient. They're not God. So how do they hear all those prayers that are on earth when they're in heaven separated from us?
Right. So what I would say here is the saint's ability to know anything will come from God imparting that knowledge to them. So any time a human being has miraculous or supernatural knowledge, it's going to come from some kind of spiritual power. So it could be somebody could be demonically possessed, for example, and have knowledge a natural human being normally would not possess, because spiritual beings, they're not omniscient, but they do know a lot. So I would say that the saints who are given these abilities by God, it allows them to have a wide array of knowledge. They don't have to be omniscient. So when people bring this up, they say, oh, for the saints to be able to answer all these prayers, you know, don't they have to be omniscient? No, because omniscience means that you know all things. Only God knows everything. That's an infinite amount of knowledge. Like God knows all of the mathematics involved with infinity, right? Unless somebody asks for a saint to intercede about the value of pi, and nobody needs to know that, God knows that. The saints don't need to know that, or just many, many other truths that the saints don't need to know. If you think about it, the knowledge that the saints possess in heaven in relation to God's infinite knowledge, it's almost the same distance as our knowledge to God's knowledge, because any finite amount compared to infinity kind of disappears into the void when you think about it. That's one thing I would bring up, is that the saints don't have infinite knowledge. They do have a great, so they're not omniscient like God. God has infinite knowledge. The saints do not. They do have a lot of knowledge, no doubt there, or at least a lot more than normal human beings. And if they're given all these prayer requests, how do they understand that? I'm trying this reply out right now because I've never actually said this before, so we'll see if it lands on deaf ears or not. But I feel like the devil is sure able to know a lot about our individual temptations. Like, the devil is an angel, of course, but he's not God, and yet the devil and demons seem to have a lot of knowledge about what's necessary to tempt billions of human beings at the same time. They're able to do that. Wouldn't God be able to give his friends, the saints, abilities that rival, if not surpass, the devil in knowing what we need and being able to pray for us? Surely God would be able to do that. If God is able to give human beings on earth supernatural knowledge of the future, prophecy, he can give the saints in heaven supernatural knowledge of everything happening on earth. Deuteronomy 29:29 puts it this way: the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things that are revealed belong to us and to our children forever. I would also say, and then I'll add one last little tidbit here. Well, two things. One, the saints don't have to know everything about our situations to pray for us, right? Like, we pray for one another, as we could say, hey, can you pray for me? Sure. Well, we don't have to know the person's entire backstory. We pray for them. So that was one. I have one other point I was going to raise. I don't know. I'm sure I'll raise it a little bit later, but I've thrown a lot out at you there. I guess, yeah, I don't see why. It's not infinite knowledge that God... Oh, sorry. Time maybe just works a little bit differently for God to allow the saints to have enough time, and he gives them unending stamina to make these intercessory requests for us. I apologize for throwing a lot out at you, Brandon, but it's a question I haven't gotten in a while, and it's neat to think about. How is that as a start? Would you like follow up on anything, or what do you think of that?
Yeah, I guess I get some of that, but my counter would be, well, if they're also getting it from God, so is God hearing these prayers and bouncing it off them and then goes back to him? What would be the point when you could just pray directly to God?
Sure. And what I would say is that anything that exists in the world, right, anything that exists only exists because God sustains it. Like, the reason you and I exist is because God wills it. If God didn't will our existence, we wouldn't continue. So it's like, why do we ask a friend to pray for us, right? As soon as we think of the prayer request and ask the friend to pray for us, God has already become God has known it timelessly for all eternity what the request is. In sustaining our very existence, he's the one who makes it possible for our friend to know our request and to be able to make it to him. It seems like we get the same middleman problem. Like, if the idea of seeking the saint's intercession turns God into a middleman, seeking a friend's intercession on earth would sort of do the same thing. Now, how God allows the saints to be aware of it, that's kind of beyond our scope to know how he makes them aware of the knowledge of things that are happening on earth. But just because God is responsible for it, it doesn't mean there isn't an important role. And the important role is, I would just say it's the same as we have for people here on earth, that when we ask one another to pray for each other, this is an act of love towards fellow members of the body of Christ, and that other prayers are efficacious for people. And God wants us as a body, as Galatians 6:2 says, to bear one another's burdens, and in doing so, fulfill the royal law of Christ. If you would like, if you stay on the line, I'd be happy to send you my book, Why We're Catholic, and adds a chapter on seeking the intercession of the saints. But Brandon, I thank you very much for your insightful questions, and I'd love for you to call back at any time. I wish we had longer to be able to chat about this.
Thanks, Brandon. Hang on the line if you'd like the book. We'll take a quick break. Be right back with more Why Aren't You Catholic with Trent Horn on Catholic Answers Live.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
It's really awe-inspiring to know that Take Two with Jerry and Debbie has the impact that it does. We know from what our listeners share on the air, but also from corresponding with them outside of the show via email and social media. There's no better feeling than knowing you've helped someone, maybe many people at a time, work through various situations and more clearly see God's purpose and plan for their lives.
Take Two with Jerry and Debbie, tomorrow, noon Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Trent Horn, our guest this hour. Next hour, John Martignoni. With John, we'll do some biblical apologetics. If you've got biblical apologetics questions about using the Bible and defending the Catholic faith, or maybe ways in which you have had Bible verses or books of the Bible used to challenge Catholic faith, John Martignoni, perfect person to talk to about that. This hour, we're asking folks, because Trent Horn is our guest, why aren't you Catholic? And then we'll have a nice conversation about it. At least that's how it's gone so far. Maybe it'll keep going that way. Laurel in Missouri, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. You are up next, Laurel. Nope, you are not up next, Laurel. Laurel just dropped the very moment that I said her name. Michael in Arkansas, watching on YouTube. You're up next. Michael, why aren't you Catholic?
Thank you for taking my call. My issue that I'm having is I've looked at the Calvinist viewpoint of predestination. Mm-hmm. It seems like it's more set in stone, and the Catholic view of predestination, it's a lot of different opinions, and I was just trying to figure out what's the best route and if you guys recommend any books to further my knowledge on the subject.
Mm. Okay, yeah, so... Well, I guess, Michael, I can offer a short explanation, and then I would just be curious what do you mean by set in stone? Are you talking about that the doctrine of predestination is very narrow and understood, or that what God predestines is set in stone?
Well, it seems like the Calvinist viewpoint, the whole tulip thing, is kind of set in stone. Like, it's just there, and
right, yeah.
They're kind of, like, done with it. And I know that the Catholic viewpoint, I think Thomas Aquinas has a viewpoint on it, and there's another gentleman, I forget his name, has another viewpoint on it too. And I'm just trying to coordinate with how to view, how to see the Catholic viewpoint.
Right.
I'm sorry, my kids.
Are you trying to understand the Catholic and Calvinist view of predestination while a baby is crying? Because I think that might be the greatest intellectual feat in history, if that's what you're doing right now.
Yeah, that's so. Now, you know, it's funny. Now that I have three kids, I'm an absolute sucker for this stuff. So tell that little goober I said hi. That's so. I think that's all cute. Whenever babies cry in mass, I'm always like, I love it. At least somebody's honest that they don't want to be here. The rest of you are just. Some of you are just lying through your teeth. Somebody, at least someone has the guts to say they don't want to.
Oh, man.
Hey, I'd rather have, if someone doesn't want to be there, they're just honest about it. But anywho, thank you for your question. Yeah, I would say that so the Catholic view on predestination is more about a teaching of what you can't believe than about what you can believe, because it is a very theologically difficult question that people like St. Thomas Aquinas or Luis de Molina, you're probably thinking of, who had developed a system of understanding predestination called Molinism. And then there are other views, even beyond them, that it's something the church has left relatively open for theologians to figure out. Rather, the church's teaching is more about what you can't believe. The Catechism just says in paragraph 600, to God, all moments of time are present in their immediacy. When, therefore, he establishes his eternal plan of predestination, he includes in it each person's free response to his grace. So there are basically two extremes on the question of predestination. And it would be on the subjects of whether God determines the future and we don't have freedom, or we do have freedom, but God doesn't know the future. In one sense, God determines the future in that he creates the universe, he sustains it, he knows what's going to happen, but our free choices are a part of God's divine plan. So the Calvinist view would deny human freedom, and that would be something the church says you can't. And you can't redefine freedom so that it's meaningless. Like, some people will say, well, you're free because you did what you wanted to do, but you're not in control of your wants or developing virtue or habits, that if you're only free to do what you want, but somebody else controlled 100% of your wants, you're not really free. So that'd be like a compatibilist view of freedom. So that'd be the Calvinist view denies human freedom. You cannot hold that view as a Catholic. The other extreme would be to hold to human freedom, but to say that the only way that we're free is that God just doesn't know the future. We decide, and God kind of makes it up as we decide. God just responds to it. He's just the perfect game player. He knows he has a prepared list of moves. That would be called open theism. So between those two views, there is a wide array. But you just have to believe that God does know the future infallibly. But humans are genuinely free, and God incorporates our freedom into his plan. How he does that, there's different analogies that are given and different schemes that have been developed to explain that. You have, for example, going back to Boethius and worked over into Aquinas, the idea that God sees all moments of time at once. Like, if I stand on a high tower and I see two cars traveling, I know they're going to hit each other, but my knowledge is not what causes them to hit. I just know what's going to happen because of my unique vantage point. It's not a great analogy, but it's not hopeless. And then there's Molina's view, which says God makes a world. He knows what we would do in certain circumstances, and he just creates a world based on what we would do, and we're still free. I worry about getting into the weeds here because it gets very sticky, but do you understand, at least, Michael, the two bookends, the Calvinist view and the open theist view? Catholicism just says it's somewhere in between. You're free to pick whatever you want. And I would say, I noticed you mentioned earlier set in stone. I think that it is I would rather belong to a religion that leaves an issue open and does not answer, rather than belong to a religion that specifically gives an incorrect answer. So for me, the fact that a religion has a specific answer like Calvinism on predestination, that doesn't attract me to Calvinism any more than open theism has a specific answer. They're both specific, but they're just both wrong. I know it's somewhere in between, and whether it's Thomism or Molinism, it's somewhere within the Catholic accepted view, and that sits just well with me. But that's a start. When it comes to books, I believe John Salza wrote a book on predestination a while ago. Let me see if I can find it right here. Now, I think this is more of a Thomistic view. It's called The Mystery of Predestination According to Scripture, the Church, and St. Thomas Aquinas. If you want, stay on the line with your email. We could send you the article my friend Jim Yakin wrote, A Tiptoe Through Tulip, that compares Calvinism to Catholicism. I don't know if it does a lot on predestination, but it does compare Tulip, which is helpful. But Mystery of Predestination by John Salza. If you would like a take on the Molinist view of predestination, which Catholics can believe in, a short treatment of it that is ironically not written by a Catholic, it's written by a Protestant philosopher named William Lane Craig, is called The Only Wise God. And that is a very short book that defends the Molinist view of predestination. So Salza, The Mystery of Predestination, that's probably more of a Thomistic view. The Only Wise God is a Molinist account. So that might be where I would start, and we could send you A Tiptoe Through Tulip. Is that a good start, at least, Michael, to help you go on?
Yes, I very much appreciate it. You dissecting all that kind of helps it put it more in perspective for me.
Michael,
great.
Stay quiet. The baby is clearly sleeping now. Take it easy, Michael. Just hang up the phone quietly. No, don't hang up yet. We need your address to send. We're going to send the Tiptoe through Tulip. Is that right, Trent?
Yes, Tiptoe Through Tulip.
All right, Michael, call back sometime. We'd love to talk with you again. I do want to get to Alejandro, however, in Maryland, listening to EWTN on Channel 130 Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Alejandro, I'm sorry we only have a couple minutes. Are you there with us?
Hello?
Hello, Alejandro. How old are you?
I am 12.
Well, we are very honored to have your call. I'm sorry we only have a couple minutes, so go ahead with your question for Mr. Horn, and we'll get you the best answer we can.
My question is, I have two, actually, but my main question is, what was Jesus' real last name?
Well, he didn't have a last name, because that is more of a modern invention. With so many people around. In Jesus' time, most people were known as by their first name, and then they were known as someone from a certain place or someone who is the son of someone else. So Jesus was referred to as Jesus of Nazareth, because that is where he came from. Christ is his title. He's Jesus the Christ or Jesus the Messiah. But he just had the name Jesus, and he was known by those various titles and descriptions.
Okay, Alejandro?
Got it. And Joseph is his adoptive father. So
that's right.
So God is his paternal father. But would God, if God didn't create Jesus, and if God didn't choose Mary, if he had a different plan, would we still be technically around in these days?
Would human beings be around? Well, God the Son became man, became the man Jesus Christ, and he did that in response to sin. If God had not done that, he could have forgiven our sins another way. If he did that, history might have been a lot different. And if history were a lot different, you know, things wouldn't have happened. Like, your parents might not have met each other if history was really different. So you or I might not be here because of that. But he would still show his love for us. But Alejandro, stay on the line. Don't hang up. Give us your email. I want to send you Why We're Catholic, because you asked super good questions. So Alejandro, do not hang up. Give us your email. We'll send you Why We're Catholic.
Alejandro, thanks very much. Hang on. Edgar's going to talk with you. Trent Horn, I didn't even mention The Council of Trent, one of the most popular Catholic podcasts in the world, of which you are the host and proprietor, TrentHornPodcast.com. And you got about 20 seconds if you want to tell us anything about it.
I just had an episode called The Best Way Catholics Can Attract Protestants. The best way, if you want to find out, check out the Council of Trent.
Check out the Council of Trent. You can find it at TrentHornPodcast.com. As promised, coming up next, John Martignoni. We're going to do a little bit of Bible apologetics. Trent, thanks very much.
Of course.
Right back. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We'll do a little bit of scripture apologetics this hour. You got scripture questions you want to ask about how to do Catholic apologetics using scripture? You are welcome to call 888-318-7884. And we got just one of the best for you this hour. John Martignoni is our guest. He's the founder and president of the Bible Christian Society, an apologetics and evangelization apostolate that reaches hundreds of thousands of people each year across the United States and all around the world, actually. For 17 years, he hosted EWTN Radio's Open Line. He also has a regular e-newsletter, Apologetics for the Masses, that has more than 40,000 subscribers in all 50 states and also all around the world. And he's currently the director of evangelization for the Diocese of Birmingham in Alabama. John Martignoni, thanks for being with us.
Si, it's a pleasure to be with you guys as always.
Well, thank you. Last week, we celebrated our 25th anniversary, and Edgar here, he said, you know, the Bible Christian Society is even older than that. So we looked it up, and it. What are you on, 27 years with the Bible Christian Society?
Let's see. I would say probably 26, yes.
Wow. So, folks can call 888-318-7884, but while we're allowing them to dial the phone, 888-318-7884. I want to ask you about the Bible Christian Society. What is it? What does it do?
Well, the Bible Christian Society was born I don't know by accident's the right word, but I heard a very anti-Catholic program on the largest evangelical radio station in the state of Alabama, which is, they've got the network has a station here, and it's 100,000 watt FM. It's, you know, it's a blowtorch. And I called to complain, and one thing led to another about the anti-Catholic program, and I ended up writing them a letter complaining about their programming and how anti-Catholic it was, and I signed the letter John Martignoni, and I said, they don't care who John Martignoni is, so I made up the Bible Christian Society, and I made myself the president. Nice. I signed it John Martignoni, president of the Bible Christian Society. And basically what I've been doing since then through the Bible Christian Society is apologetics and evangelization, giving talks at parishes and conferences around the country, doing radio, having audio things that have been going on through the Bible Christian Society, distributed audio all over the country, all over the world. So, and I've got a newsletter. It's just amazing, amazing what's happening.
So you went right to the top, though. You didn't think about maybe making yourself vice president first or something like that. You went straight for president of the Bible Christian Society.
Yeah. Why start at the bottom? Just start at the top.
Why would I just start at the top? Right. One of the things that we see on, you know, a lot of, not all, I don't want to say all, but a lot of Protestant radio and Protestant television has a good deal on it about the rapture. We still see this today, long after the publication of many of the kind of original contemporary rapture texts. But what's the Catholic view of the rapture? Do we read scripture in a different way than Protestants in order to come to our view of the rapture?
Well, I would say yes, in the sense that we read scripture in the accurate way, and basically the Left Behind books, which really popularized the what we call a pre-tribulation rapture, which they were published 20 years plus ago and sold tens of millions of copies. Well, that has that Jesus Christ, right before the Great Tribulation that the Catholic Church teaches will occur towards the end of time, Jesus Christ comes back and takes all the true Christians, which means no Catholics, off the planet and back to heaven with him so they don't have to suffer through the tribulation. But the Catholic Church says, no. That's and they get that from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13, 17, around there. But it doesn't really say anything like that. So the rapture, as Catholics believe it, is... We can believe in a rapture, but it's something where all the people who are waiting for Christ to return at the end of time are caught up in the air to meet him as he journeys for his second and final time back to earth for, you know, the resurrection of the dead and the final judgment and all that kind of stuff. So Catholic rapture, yes, it's a possibility, but nothing like what the Protestants believe.
So how do we get so different on this? Because it, is it just a few lines of scripture being misinterpreted that led to such a kind of grave difference on our understanding of the end times?
Yes, actually it is. Just a few lines in regards to the rapture. The Left Behind books, for example, they took a line from Matthew 27, and there's basically the same line in Luke 17, talks about how the day of the Lord, that there will be two men in the field, one will be taken, one will be left. There will be two women at the grinding mill, grinding out their cornmeal or whatever. Mm-hmm. One will be taken, one will be left. And the Protestants say, see, one is left, one is taken. That's the rapture. But if you read 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, where they supposedly get their rapture from, Paul talks about those who are left will get to see the Lord. And then if you read Matthew 24 and Luke 17, it says the day of the Lord will be like the days of Noah. And in Luke, it says the days of Noah and the days of Lot. Well, Si, let me ask you something. After the flood in the days of Noah, who was left behind, the good guys or the bad guys?
Unless I misinterpreted that, those were the good guys that made it in the boat.
The good guys were left. The bad guys were swept away. Same with Lot. After Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed, who was left behind? Well, it was Lot and his family, the good guys. So the Left Behind books actually get it 180 degrees opposite of what the Bible actually teaches. That you want to be left behind, because again, in 1 Thessalonians 4, it says those who are left get to greet the Lord up in the air on his return to earth at the end of time.
Again, our number is 888-318-7884. Scriptural Apologetics this hour with John Martignoni, 888-318-7884. Passages of Scripture are used to challenge the Catholic faith, to challenge the Catholic Church. If you've had that experience and you'd like some help responding, just give us a call, 888-318-7884. Other passages of Scripture used to make assertions about this or that teaching of a non-Catholic Christian church, or in some cases, a non-Christian understanding of the person of Jesus. If any of that you'd like some help with, 888-318-7884. John Martignoni, as I said, was the long time host over on EWTN of
Open Line.
I don't know why I blanked on Open Line. Closed Mind, Open Line. And the founder of the Bible Christian Society. I'm going to take a quick break. We'll be back with your calls for John Martignoni. 888-318-7884.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
He was a doctor of the church, a Carmelite, and one of the most famous mystics of all time.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
St. John of the Cross wanted to help all Christians to become saints. One of his most important teachings was to encourage us all to learn how to love. Where there is no love, he said, put love, and you will find love. He died in 1591.
To find out more about the Doctors of the Church, visit EWTN.com and click on Catholicism.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, John Martignoni, our guest, longtime host of Open Line over on the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network. And we're doing scriptural apologetics. If there's something in the scripture where you go, you know, like I'll give you an example of one where the scriptures seem to say, call no man father, or Christ himself seems to say, because he does say it, and yet Catholics call priests father. What's the deal? These are the kind of scriptural apologetics questions that we get, and you are welcome to call and ask about, whether you're Catholic or not, 888-3187-884. I do want to tell you, however, I mention Edgar here every now and then on the air, and one of the things that Edgar does is he's the producer for a growing list of podcasts here at Catholic Answers. So I want to give you the list in case you weren't aware of some of the podcasts we have available. The Council of Trent podcast, of course, one of the most popular Catholic podcasts on the planet Earth. You can get that just simply by going to TrentHornPodcast.com. Our own Catholic Answers Focus podcast has a new episode every Wednesday. Just look for Catholic Answers Focus in your search browser there, or just go to CatholicAnswersFocus.com and you'll find us. Joe Heschmeyer has a brand new podcast that follows up his blog that he used to have, Shameless Popery. It's called the Shameless Popery Podcast. New episodes every Thursday at that. ShamelessJoe.com is where to go for that one. ShamelessJoe.com. We got the brand new Jimmy Akin. Are you impressed with how much work Edgar is doing? We've got a brand new Jimmy Akin podcast called The Daily Defense. It's the Daily Defense Podcast. New episode every single day this year. And Carlo Broussard, of course, has his new podcast, The Sunday Catholic Word, with new episodes every Friday. What he does is he takes the Sunday scripture readings and he does Catholic apologetics with them. So it does two things. It helps you to sharpen your apologetic skills as a Catholic, but also prepares you for the hearing the proclamation of the word at Sunday Mass. That's SundayCatholicWord.com. John Martignoni, as I said, is our guest. John, are you ready to head to the phones?
I am. Let's have at it.
All right. Let's start with Jack in Columbus, Ohio, listening on St. Gabriel Radio. Jack, thank you for your patience. Go ahead with your question for John Martignoni.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question. I had a question about some of the passages in the Bible seem to indicate that God was bargaining with Satan. For instance, Job, when they seemed to be discussing that he, if everything was taken away from Job, he would no longer, be a friend of God. And so they seemed to have some discussion about that. And then also in the New Testament, with when Jesus foretells the denial of Peter, he said Satan wished to sift you like wheat. I guess, you know, as God, he knows everything that's going on, but he seems to allow these sort of things at the request of Satan. So I was trying to understand how that works, and if you could help me with that, I appreciate it.
Well, what I would say, number one, is that it's very difficult with in our limited finite minds, with our limited language in terms of describing God, to talk about God and his actions and his essence, his being, and how he operates in a way that we can fully get our arms around. But in regard to bargaining with Job or with Satan over Job, or that Satan asked to sift Peter and the apostles like wheat, in essence, what's going on there is, you touched on it in what you were saying, is that God's will, he doesn't cause evil, and he doesn't want evil, but he allows evil to happen, or he allows, in essence, Satan testing us, he allows that to happen, not for Satan's gain or because Satan is saying, hey, this is what I want, God, you need to give it to me, because God recognizes that it is good for us, that we can become stronger out of this testing. And so it's not that Satan gets what he wants from God and maybe when we pray, we don't a lot of the times. It's just that God is doing something that allows us to be, or is allowing something to happen that will test us, test our mettle, test our spirituality, test our commitment to the will of God. And he's doing that for our own good so that we can grow in holiness. So it's more for us. Satan is essentially asking God for something that God knows will help us as we pass that test.
So does that help you? Does that clarify it for you?
Yeah, and apparently God knows what we're going to do or how we're going to come out in the test. So I guess
he does.
He figures he's got an ace up his sleeve.
Absolutely right. So Satan can come to God with a lot of things and ask him a lot of things, but God isn't necessarily going to go, oh, yeah, I'll let you have John's soul or Cy's soul or whatever. That, no, he doesn't get what he wants just because he asks.
Jack, thank you very much. Appreciate the call and the question. The number is 888-318-7884 if you have a question for John Martignoni on scriptural apologetics. Questions along the lines of how we can justify certain Catholic teachings, given what the Bible teaches. Maybe challenges to the Catholic faith that you have experienced in the Bible. If you want some help with those, 888-318-7884, the number. I want to give you a drop call because this is one I know that many, many people puzzle over. Ed in Michigan, listening to EWTN on Channel 130 Sirius XM Satellite Radio, wasn't able to stay on the line, but asks or says, the teaching of purgatory bothers me. Where is that explicitly in the Bible?
Okay. It's not explicitly in the Bible. However, one of my apologetic strategies that I teach people is it's the principle of the thing. It's drawing Catholic principles out of Scripture. And purgatory is one of those things that it's not specifically mentioned in the Bible, but it is there in the Bible. And I'll go through something real quick here using four Bible verses. 2 Samuel 12, verses 13 to 18. Nathan, the prophet, comes to David after David has committed adultery with Bathsheba and essentially allowed Bathsheba's husband to be killed in battle. So he's an adulterer and a murderer. And the prophet says something to David. David realizes he's talking about him. And David repents. So the prophet says, well, the Lord has put away your sin. In other words, God has forgiven you. But Nathan says, because you've done this thing, the child that is born to you shall die. So the principle from that verse is that even though sin has been forgiven, there very well could be punishment due to that sin that occurs after the sin is forgiven. So then we move to another verse. Revelation 21:27 says that nothing with the stain of sin or nothing unclean or as I said, nothing with the stain of sin will enter heaven, the New Jerusalem, as it's called in Revelation 21. Well, that's just pretty straightforward. Nothing with the stain of sin enters heaven. So if you die with the stain of sin on your soul, well, you can't enter directly into heaven. Hebrews 12, verse 22 and 23 talks about coming to the heavenly Mount Zion, to the God who is the God of all, to the gathering of festal angels, and to the souls of the just made perfect. So there's obviously some process by which the souls of the just, those we would say in Catholic theology, those who die in a state of grace, are made perfect. One more verse, 1 Corinthians 3, 13, 15, talks about how on the day you die, that your works will be tested. And, you know, if you got some works that are kind of not all that great, that they could be burned up and you could suffer loss as through fire, yet still be saved. So the question is, where is it after you die that your works could be tested and you could suffer loss as through fire, yet still be saved? Is it hell? Well, you suffer loss as through fire and hell, but you don't get saved. Is it heaven? Well, no, you don't suffer loss as through fire in heaven. So where is it? There must be this other place. So you put those four together, There's a possibility of punishment due to sin even after the sin's been forgiven. Nothing with the stain of sin enters heaven. There is some process by which the souls of the just are made perfect. And there's this other place other than heaven or hell or state of being where after you die, you can suffer loss as through fire yet still be saved. You put all those together and you've got what we Catholics call purgatory.
I was going to go back to our caller, but our caller dropped. I forgot that. So thank you very much, John Martignoni. John Martignoni, our guest. Scriptural Apologetics this hour. If you have questions about defending the faith using Scripture, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. We go now to Houston, Texas. Keith in Houston, Texas, listening on 1430 AM. Glad you're here, Keith. Go ahead with your question for John Martignoni.
Hey, Cy. Good evening, John. Hey, I'm so glad that you took my call. I have tried to think about this your way, and I wonder if maybe if you look at it the way the Protestants do, maybe they're correct in thinking that left behind doesn't describe Noah and his family or Lot and his family, that they were the ones who were saved and they survived those calamities, but the people who were left behind were the ones who didn't get in the ark and who didn't flee the city, and they perished and they were destroyed. If you thought of it that way, John, what would you say?
I would say that on first glance, that might sound reasonable, except it says in Luke 17, it talks about the flood taking them away. They're being swept away by the flood. And then again in 1 Thessalonians 4, where it talks about this event that's where Protestant theology gets their rapture from, 1 Thessalonians 4, is that it says those who are left will be there to greet the Lord. And then the other thing is that in 1 Thessalonians 4, before this so-called rapture, there's a resurrection of the dead. The only time there's a resurrection of the dead in Scripture is at the end of the world. So... No, I've tried to look at it, or I have looked at it through Protestant lenses, and it just doesn't work when you put all the verses together, all the passages together from Matthew 24, Luke 17, and 1 Thessalonians 4.
Keith, what do you think?
I need to re-listen to it and go back through those, but yes, I think you answered it well. I just can't get it all in through my head as fast as you can say it. So thanks, John.
Yeah, okay. Right. So it's posted. You can listen to it as many times as you like, Keith. John, you were about to say something else?
No. I'm just telling probably you guys are recorded, so we can go back and listen again.
Yeah. Keith, thank you. A very gracious call. Maybe you'll listen to it and say, no, wait a second, I still got an objection. Well, we're here all the time. You can always call back. Let's go to Andrew.
And one thing, Scott,
yes,
if
John.
I don't mind him. He can go to my website, BibleChristianSociety.com. And if he goes to one of my talks, I've got a bunch of talks there that he can listen straight off the website or MP3 download. And there's one called The Rapture and the Bible, and it goes through it a whole lot more detail than what I just did.
So check that out, the Bible Christian Society, Keith. Thanks very much. That is where John Martignoni is the president and has been 27 years as the president. Matter of fact, he started as the president of the Bible Christian Society. We got time. Let's go to Florida. Andrew in Florida, listening on the app, the Catholic Answers Live app. Andrew, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for John Martignoni.
Hello, gentlemen. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 28, I believe, it says that Jesus, quoting, saying to his disciples, "Some of you who are standing here will not taste death until you see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." And there's a similar verse in Matthew 24, verse 34. So is that Jesus predicting that the second coming would happen in the first century when some of his disciples hadn't died yet? And if I believe that, am I considered unorthodox by Catholic definition?
Well, to answer to the latter question first, is yes. Jesus was not predicting that the second coming would happen in the first century. What you can read a number of scholars, I think particularly of Scott Hahn, some of his materials that I've read and listened to, is that, number one, Jesus talks about on the cross about the ushering in of the kingdom of heaven, of his kingdom. So, that's one possibility. Other possibilities, Scott Hahn and others have mentioned, is that the destruction of Jerusalem, that was in essence the Son of Man coming in his kingdom, because the old covenant is essentially done away with there, and that's the ushering in of the new covenant. And then the church is the kingdom of heaven on earth. So all of those things play into that.
Andrew, thanks. You can hear the music, I suppose. We got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Scriptural Apologetics with John Martignoni on Catholic Answers Live. The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement. But the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whyweareprolife.com.
Want to know more about the origins of the Catholic Church? Joe Heschmeyer explores the beginnings of Christianity in The Early Church Was the Catholic Church. Joe digs deep into the words and actions of those who lived right after the apostles to refute anti-Catholic claims of how the faith was lived back then. Order your copy of The Early Church Was the Catholic Church today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
As Catholic apologetics have gotten stronger, Protestant responses have gotten stronger as well. And now they have their own answers to rebut the standard Catholic proofs. Don't fret, we've got you covered. In his new book, Meeting the Protestant Response, apologist Carlo Broussard gives well-reasoned biblical answers to Protestant comebacks. Order your copy of Meeting the Protestant Response today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Janet Williams. Please join us for Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Killett, your host. And you spent the month of December finding the perfect gifts for all the loved ones on your list. Now it's time to take care of little old you. Visit shop.catholic.com and take advantage of our 23-23-23 New Year's special. Spend $23 or more in our online shop at shop.catholic.com. Enter the promo code New Year at checkout and save 23%. It's that easy. Just enter the promo code New Year when you check out at shop.catholic.com and save 23% on your order. The number here is 888-318-7884. We're doing some scriptural apologetics with John Martignoni. Sometimes folks read the scriptures and look at it and go, well, that doesn't make any sense. That can't make any sense. And you need somebody who has studied the scriptures to help you make sense of it. Sometimes folks will look in the scriptures and say, well, that doesn't fit with what the church teaches. And again, a little bit of help can go a long way in some of those situations. If you have a situation like that, whether it's your own or someone else you'd like to help, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. John Martignoni is the founder and president of the Bible Christian Society, and he's the director of evangelization for the Diocese of Birmingham in Alabama. John, what does a director of evangelization do? You go out there and just share the good news?
Well, for the most part, I have been. It's about evangelizing Catholics more than evangelizing non-Catholics.
Right.
And particularly here in Alabama, we're what, about 3 to 4% of the population, and so many Catholics are influenced by Protestant theology. I mean, there's a number of Catholics who believe in the rapture, as the Protestants teach it. There are some Catholics who believe in salvation by faith alone. And generally, these might be Catholics who have been converted from Protestant denominations, and they still haven't been properly catechized. So a lot of what I do is evangelizing Catholics. I've done things like right now, one of the things I'm doing is I've got a multi-year project to send a catechism of the Catholic Church to every non-Catholic pastor in the diocese, along with a letter saying, please accept this gift from us. And should you ever feel the need to speak about the Catholic Church from the pulpit in a Bible study or your Sunday school, you can get it straight from the horse's mouth. You know, and I had the head of a Baptist seminary approve the letter and even strengthen the letter for me. So, and I've gotten, you know, we've sent out several hundred over the last few years, and we've gotten about a 1 to 2% response, but every response has been positive, at least every response that had a name on it. I've gotten one or two envelopes filled with anti-Catholic tracts with no return address, and I'm thinking, well, I bet that was one of the pastors I sent a catechism to.
Yeah, I sure hear. Thanks for that. I'll give you this. You remind me of the Jehovah's Witnesses. They haven't come for a while to my house, but when they come, I always have the diocesan newspaper ready to go for them. But they don't like to take literature from me. They want me to take literature from them. But
pretty much, yep.
The number is 888-318-7884. If you'd like to engage in a little bit of scriptural apologetics with John Martignoni, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884, 888-31-TRUTH. One of the things that I have a very hard time with, John, is the brief conversation with a Protestant believer who challenges my Catholic faith in a kind of almost passing way, you know, like we'll say, you know, well, I don't believe in praying to saints, and I my faith is in Jesus. And sometimes I'm like, 5 minutes after they leave, I'm like, my faith is in Jesus too. Like, I figure out what my response should have been. I don't know if you run into that, but that's why I always find like just practicing a little bit helps. But man, I think of good answers way too late all the time.
Well, and I'll tell you, that doesn't happen to me as much as it used to. But when I first got into apologetics, that's how I learned. Somebody would ask me a question and I would go, gosh, I have no clue. Or even when I got started on the Protestant radio, there was a woman who did a show before ours. Our show was live every Sunday night, and it was a Protestant, I guess she was a female pastor of some denomination. And after a few weeks, she realized these are Catholics coming in, and we're passing in the hallway. She's leaving, and I'm coming in to do my show. And she says, you Catholics and your beliefs about Mary, don't you know she was just an incubator for Jesus? Oof. And just kept walking? I know. And I was stunned. I was like, I have no idea. You know, number one, I'd never heard that. So what do I say to that? But number two, just the fact that she said that just stunned me into silence. But then I finally thought about it. And, you know, a couple weeks later, I was like, yeah, that's what Elizabeth said. Who am I that the incubator of my Lord should come to me? You know, it's right there in Scripture.
So go ahead,
use those instances to do exactly what you said, to practice, well, okay, if I had had my total wits about me and could have come back, what should I have said? And then pray, God, give me another opportunity. And as you do that and you get the answers ready in your head, you'll get the questions and you'll be able to hit them with the answers on the spot.
Oh, I've been waiting for years now for another Protestant to say to me, my faith is in Jesus, because, man, oh, I am ready now. I am ready now, John. The number again, 888-318-7884. I do have some calls I want to get to, but I want to ask you this, John, before I do, because in what you do, it seems to me there's two kinds of objections that we face to the Catholic faith. And one of the objections is the person who doesn't understand Catholic teaching. Like, why do you worship Mary, or why do you make Mary higher than Jesus, or something like that? And then there's the person who has an objection to the Catholic faith that actually does understand the Catholic faith, like the Protestant person who says, well, you believe that the bread and wine turn into the body and blood of Jesus, you know? And I feel like I like the second one better. I like it better to go, yep, you're right, that's what we believe. Shocking, isn't it? And then we can have a conversation. But how do you approach, like, those are two different types of objections. And do you approach them differently, or are you always just of the mind, I'm just going to give the clearest answer I can, whatever?
Well, I generally approach them I'd say basically the same way. Because my approach is to respond by asking them a question. And so by asking questions, I get to realize, I get to find out, okay, exactly where are you? Yeah, you know, you're accusing us of worshiping Mary, so I'm going to ask you, well, why do you think that way? What is it about the Catholic teaching? Because they've obviously heard something, or that, you know, the old adage, a little learning is a dangerous thing, drink deeper, taste not the Pierian spring. So they've got a little learning about the Catholic faith. Then there are those you mentioned who say, well, you believe it's the body and blood, soul and divinity of Jesus Christ. I disagree with that. Why do you believe? So they have a little more knowledge, but basically I approach them the same way. I just ask questions. The ones that get me, and I won't mention any names here, but there are some professional Protestant apologists who will go into the catechism and they'll say, Catholics believe such and such. Here's the line in the catechism that proves that. Well, the very next line gives context that shows that what they're saying is the exact opposite of what it says in the catechism. And they know it's there, and they've read it, and they purposely leave that out, you know? And those are the ones that drive me nuts, because the other two I can work with. The other two, if you're asking me an honest question, whether it's from little knowledge or a lot of knowledge about the Catholic faith, I can deal with that. When you're being purposely deceptive and malicious, that's the ones that just they get under my skin a little bit.
Yeah, because you can't do anything to address bad faith. There's nothing; it's not in your control. No. You can't give the other person a good faith question. If their question is asked in bad faith, you can't do anything about it.
Nope, not at all.
Let me give you a question. Here's another question that dropped, but Noah in California was watching on YouTube, wants to know, how do I respond to the claim that Mary had more children than just Jesus?
Okay. Yes, we'll see. Well, number one, you see in one of the very first verses people cite for that is Mark 6, verse 3, where it says, is not this the carpenter, or the son of Mary? Are not his brothers James and Joseph, Judas and Simon, and his sisters here with us? And they say, see, it names four of his brothers. Well, those first two brothers in Mark 6, verse 3, James and Joseph, if you turn to Mark 15 at the foot of the cross, they talk about Mary, the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph, and Salome. And it's a different Mary than Mary, the mother of Jesus. So right there, you show that the first two in that list, James and Joseph, they're not sons of Mary. Well, if the first two listed aren't, then probably the second two aren't. And then you have in Ezekiel, what is it? I'm trying to think, chapter 44. This is one of my favorite verses on Mary and her perpetual virginity. Let me get to it real quick. Ezekiel 44, verses 1 and 2 says this. It's talking about, you know, Ezekiel's getting this guided tour, and he says, spiritual guided tour. It says, then he brought me back to the outer gate of the sanctuary, which faces east, and it was shut. And he said to me, this gate shall remain shut. It shall not be opened, and no one shall enter by it. For the Lord, the God of Israel, has entered by it. Therefore, it shall remain shut. So a gate of the sanctuary was entered. Jesus, or the Lord God, entered through that gate. So no one else is worthy enough to enter through that gate because God had entered through it. So it was shut. Many, I won't say many, but some of the church fathers saw Mary as the gate through which Jesus has entered. The Lord God has entered this world, and therefore no one else, no other person, no mere human being would be worthy to enter through that same gate. And so they point to that verse as Mary, pointing to Mary's perpetual virginity. And again, along with the verses in the New Testament in Mark, where I said Mark 15, that shows James and Joseph, two of the supposed brothers of Jesus, well, they're not sons of the same Mary that Jesus is a son of.
That is so very helpful. It's a, you have to get, do that close reading, but there it is. And one thing that I'm going to go to a break, and then I will come back to take more calls. 888-318-7884 is our number. 888-318-7884. One thing about the Catholic Church that you will notice if you pay any attention is it's been around 2,000 years. It's not like nobody ever thought of this. And I'm always astounded at the person who thinks, oh, the church never thought to look in the Bible and see whether or not Mary had other children. But it has occurred to Catholics, and there are answers. Your calls are welcome for John Martignoni. 888-318-7884. More Scriptural Apologetics on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
This is Dr. Ray Guarendi from The Doctor Is In. You call in, and we will talk about what matters to you in your life. We can put our heads together to help you solve the problems of life and to use your faith to get even smarter.
The Doctor Is In with Dr. Ray Guarendi. Tomorrow afternoon, 1 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? Join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Is this ordinary time, Darren? Are we back in ordinary time? Because the Christmas season, it feels odd to be in ordinary time. Brief excursus into ordinary time until Lent. And once Lent starts up, then we're back in the seasons. But ordinary time is just as good as all the other time. So I'll try to get over it, but feels odd to be back in ordinary time for a brief moment here. If you have a question about Scripture, about how Scripture maybe is used against the Catholic faith, or about things that you have read in Scripture that don't make sense given what you know about the faith as taught by the Catholic Church, you are welcome to call. John Martignoni is our guest this hour, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. I have to tell you, there's quite a few lines open, and I think it may have to do with that calls have dropped. I got a whole list of dropped calls here, so I'm going to go to the dropped calls, but it also means that if you want to call, you have a very good chance of getting in right now, because I'm not sure exactly why the calls have dropped, but we're open for business, 888-318-7884. This dropped call came from Mario right here in San Diego. How could one be baptized with fire and spirit? Could you elaborate on that?
Okay. What he's referring to is a verse from Matthew 3. It's Matthew 3:11, and the similar verse in Luke 3:16. And what it says is John the Baptist is talking. He says, I baptize you with water for repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Well, you know, he's not talking about, hey, when you get baptized, somebody, you know, pours some lighter fluid on your head and then lights a match and whew, you're baptized with fire. No, he's talking about being baptized with the Holy Spirit, which is what happens through normal baptism. But then also Jesus tells us that his followers are going to be reviled and persecuted. I mean, if the Sermon on the Mount, blessed are you when men revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. So the baptism of fire is essentially, you are going, if you are a disciple of Christ, do not expect it to be easy necessarily in this life, just because you're Christ's disciples and you're a member of the body of Christ. Jesus, you know, he tells us that he can help us carry the burden, but we are going to have a burden. You know, Luke 9 says to follow him, we have to deny ourselves and pick up our cross daily. In other words, life is going to be difficult as a follower of Christ. We are going to continually be challenged and continually be reviled, persecuted. And so in that sense, we will suffer a baptism of fire as a disciple of Christ.
Mario, thank you very, very much for that call. The number here, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Several people have taken us up on the offer there to call once they heard the lines were open. So we'll go to Troy, New York, where Mike is listening on WOPG in Troy, New York. Mike, thanks very much for your call. Go ahead with your question for John Martignoni.
Hey, John, I just wonder if you think it's an effective tactic to ask some of the people that disrespect Mary, you know, and say she had other children and say she wasn't a virgin, to just justify a position in history. It seems like it's in just the last couple hundred years. And if you go back, even Luther and Calvin and Zwingli, they all had high positions of Mary. And most of them didn't believe she had other children. So I would like some of them sometimes, or maybe this tactic to be used against, people that hate the church, just to say, well, just prove to me in history that this is a fact, what you're saying, that Mary was not sinless, yeah. Or Mary was...
Using history is on the side of the Catholic. There's absolutely no doubt about that. History, scripture, logic, common sense, all on the side of the Catholic. So yes, you can say, well, you know, do you believe what Martin Luther taught? Or do you believe what John Calvin taught? And they'll say, well, you know, if they say yes, you say, well, you know, both of them believed Mary was a perpetual virgin. You know, they may not have believed in the Assumption of Mary or some other of those teachings or the Immaculate Conception, but they did hold Mary in very high esteem. And again, they did believe in the perpetual virginity of Mary. So yes, using history is definitely one of the ways you can argue or respond to arguments against Mary and the way the church honors her and the high position that we place her in. Never hurts. Again, history is on the side of the Catholic.
Verified too that, you know, all the Catholic books of the Bible were in the King James Bible right up until 1885. So said the King James website that they were dropped at around 1885. That's very recent, just because of print costs mainly. So are you familiar with that, or is a tactic, you know, with the they call the Deuterocanonic books, and according to what I saw on a website, King James website, all those the Catholic books were still in the King James Bible right in 1885. Do you know that to be true, or?
Well, somewhere around there. Basically, what happened is the King James Bible, the translators put what would be called the Deuterocanonical, those seven books of the Old Testament that we have in our Bible that Protestants don't, they put them in what they call the non-canonical section. So they dropped them from the canon, but they kept them in the book because they said, well, they're still important books. But then in the late 1800s, publishers of the Bible started thinking, you know, we can still charge the same price for the Bible, but since those seven books are in the non-canonical section, why don't we just drop them and save cost? And that way we increase our profits. So the dropping of those seven books from being contained in the same book as what the Protestants would call the canon of Scripture was driven, as I understand, more by publishers of the Bible than by churchmen. But they had basically turned them or called them non-canonical back in the 1500s with Martin Luther in his time and King Henry VIII.
Mike, thanks very, very much for the call. John, I do get the feeling like there's a lot of young people now who belong to the non-denominational churches and such who, I think many of them, even if you said, well, Luther believed this or Calvin or Zwingli believed this, it really wouldn't mean much to them because they don't really, their Christianity, as far as they understand it, is disconnected from history. They are pure, they at least in their mind, but what they're being taught is, we're just pure Bible Christians. None of that has anything to do with us. That seems to me to be where a vast field of Protestantism has gone these days. Is that your experience, John?
Yes, absolutely. It doesn't matter. You can say, well, you know, Martin Luther said, and they said, well, Martin Luther's not in the Bible. Whereas 5 minutes before they would have said, well, Martin Luther's definition of sola scriptura is this. Or, you know, you can show them, well, we've got these church fathers documents that say this was what the early church was. Well, that's not the Bible. So, yes, history doesn't mean anything to them, whether it's Catholic history, Protestant history, and more, that's exactly what you encounter. That's why so much of what I do is just coming straight from the Bible.
Mike, thanks very much for the call. I want to try to get James in Lincoln, Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio on. James, we are light on time. So if you'll give us a quick question, we'll do our best to get an answer from John Martignoni for you.
Okay. So my question is, in the Acts of the Apostles, the apostles tell the Gentiles that they are not to eat the meat of strangled animals. How does that tie back to the way Jesus died on the cross, possibly of strangulation, and how does that tie to us eating the Eucharist?
Well, I would say not really at all. In terms of strangulation, that's from the Old Testament. It was a under the Mosaic law that had to do with, and I can't give you, you know, whether it was from Numbers or Deuteronomy or something, but that was part of connection to the Old Testament, and it was something that the Jews particularly found heinous, and so they did that sort of as a discipline, not a doctrine, for the Gentiles, so that the Jewish Christians of the time would not be so offended, a concession, if you will, to the Jewish Christians at the time. But really, in terms of Jesus and possible suffocation on the cross as his method of death or the means of death, that really doesn't have anything to do with it that I'm aware of.
So when you say a concession, John, meaning to try to hold the Christian community of Gentiles and Jews together, they're basically saying don't offend your Jewish brothers and sisters by doing this.
Correct. Correct. And Paul says elsewhere, you know, you're allowed to do eat this or eat that. But if you're in front of someone or eating with someone who that would offend them, then don't do it. Don't exercise your right to do something that you can do if it's going to offend someone. And many times it was, you know, the Gentile Christian possibly offending the Jewish Christian and so forth. So, yes.
John Martignoni has been our guest. That'll wrap it up for this hour. John is the founder and president of the Bible Christian Society. And you also have a newsletter. Where can people go to get the newsletter?
BibleChristianSociety.com/newsletter, or just go to the homepage and click on the newsletter, Apologetics, and then the newsletter page. Sign up and you'll start getting them.
Well, John Martignoni, thank you very, very much. You were very gracious to come on with us on very short notice because we needed your help today, but I hope you'll be on many more times this year. I really enjoy it when you're on the show. Thank you.
Looking forward to it, Ty. Thank you.
All right, that does it for Monday. We'll see you Tuesday, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.